In medical.
He turned it at the end of the.
Just from what I read.
Come on.
Pretty little thing.
Not about meaning or content, though.
Yeah.
But as far as cover. And that is what Carol wants.
Oh, that was good, wasn't it? Oh, that was good. Come on and have some more.
Oh, so you took it, okay, make me coffee, that's all.
Okay.
It's a rainbow. Heart.
Do you see this? We're gonna build this. You're gonna work on it.
I wanna put, see if I can.
Oh. Yeah, right, well, who's gonna be on the oars?
This will be a volunteer group.
You're gonna go.
Going to the island.
I'll take a model or something.
Regular, very much. Full scale.
Full scale? I'll be working here for years, huh?
Mediterranean cruise, the one who's there, but you get to be 36 in the world on the starboard side.
You know, people pay a lot of money for that, they pay for it, come on.
Would you pay for that?
Would you pay for that?
You get to be 36 in the world.
Oh, I think.
One I have to work on, though?
Oh, I think that'd be great.
Well, before we go into the text, I would like to pledge. I have three questions, as strange as three ever came along.
Yeah.
Now look at the first. What is it in the body that produces illness? What is it in number that produces or for it to be odd? What is it in the body for it to be alive?
Before we go into the text.
Yeah.
Some random question. I thought it was the other.
Then, what's the first?
Disease. Huh? Or illness. Illness itself.
Or fever.
Fever? You want to go particular?
No.
Already?
You have to get answers. Go on, try it.
That's a fact. Fever, isn't it?
What did you do for this one?
So.
Oh. Gee. There's something about this that has a certain logic to it.
Yeah.
Like,
you think that reasoning is sound that follows that
well, that's
series?
That's what I want
to
talk about.
That kind of induction that you get to. That, what's that one? Mathematics uses that. All figures.
It's not solely the principle of life that makes the body alive. It's brought to it by the soul.
Obviously, yeah, life would have to be in the soul in order for it to be alive. Life would have to be in the body for it to be alive. That's a safe answer.
Yeah, but that would be. Then what would you do with the first one?
Okay. That would similarly be the principle of disease or illness brought to it by, it could be brought to it by some physical thing.
I
see the principle of death and the lack of the principle of becoming? You're taking apart, you're bringing together and then taking apart.
Central, isn't it? What is it in the body?
Yeah. Yeah, isn't it?
Yeah. Wake up, sucker.
Now, look, one of the ways in which you can translate this is the condition rather than a cause. The condition for it to be at all. Like, look here, see? What is it in the body for it to be alive? We want to say, as we did up here, some principle of life. The answer is simply soul. For this, he says, simply fever. Now, how do these two constitute answers to these two questions?
Well, let's see. Fever is a particular one for the body, isn't it? It's a particular name of the kind of heat that's present in the body, according to his argument. Isn't it? I haven't read this in a while, but doesn't he go down the avenue that it's heat that's in causes fever, illness in the body? Isn't there some higher principle he feels to? But fever is the particular thing that has to be present in body for it to be ill.
And that's fever.
That's fever.
Right. It's a particular...
Yeah.
It's a particular heat, right?
Yeah.
Right? It's some kind of internal heat that produces illness.
Yeah.
Right. So in the same way,
right,
there has to be something internal to the body. See, it's that's the end.
Uh-huh.
Right, that's the end. For it to be alive. They move with equal freedom from this to this.
Isn't that amazing?
And we would never.
You'd say that the soul is like a fever.
That's right.
That's great.
Yeah, they do. That is amazing.
But they just go right and say, of course. No discussion. It's completely obvious to them. Now, what are they doing? Right, what are they saying? All right, now, look. If we go to the Philebus for the idea of soul, it's the soul, it is the inherent intelligence which orders properly orders properly, rightly orders all the functions of the body. Right? It's an inherent intelligence which allows us to walk, to see, to assimilate all the information, for all the stuff going on inside of us, right, to work with perfect balance and to produce health. That's soul.
Well, Zeus, when he's fully his wings, said to order the whole universe.
That's right.
Or somebody flies or whatever that
line. That's right. And this is the cosmos, this is the cosmic intelligence in the body. The cosmic intelligence, the same thing. What this is in the body, so too in the cosmos, right, is the divine intellect. Mm-hmm. So the soul of the world. Now, let's go back. Let's take a look at it. If this kind of internal heat, see, they would say the only time you're ill is if you have a fever. Therefore, a whole bunch of things in the modern world that we might regard as someone being ill, they'd say no. No presence of the internal heat. So, it's a certain kind of illness. Well,
is that something that's common to all illness? Fever?
Well, for them,
or
it must
heat?
Be. It must be.
Heat?
No, it must be for those.
Yeah, for a particular illness.
Is anybody ever sick when they don't have heat?
Wouldn't it, yeah. Well, like I imagine someone could have all kinds of inner breakdown of the liver, heart conditions, all kinds of things without necessarily having fever. Cancer, all the different kinds of
things. When they were sick, they wouldn't have fever.
I don't know.
I don't either. I was just wondering if that's if that's like even is to...
Is that right, Paul?
2, 3, 4, 2, 5, 6,
what does all malfunctioning of the body produce an internal heat called fever?
I don't I don't know.
I don't see where it does. Now.
Yeah, does everything cause a rise in temperature?
No.
Thermometer?
No.
Every illness.
But for them.
Rockets have measured.
No. But for them, they're saying diseases.
Through mercury.
Do that. So we need to keep that.
Yeah. Disease.
We can keep that.
Could be.
Sure, a lot of thermometers sold, you know.
Yeah, they had them all over.
They still do.
Okay, look here. So the body then to be alive means to be functioning well. Were it to be ill, to be a malfunction. Internal heat. For the body, what's ever in the body, for it to be alive, they're saying it has to be this interior intelligence functioning so that all the parts work harmoniously and rightly and correctly for a higher order producing health. Why the body would not be alive. What do you call that? Is that a cause? Can you use another cause for that?
If it's something inherent, it wouldn't be a cause.
What does a cause do?
I don't think of fever as causing the illness, but as being something that's a manifestation of the illness.
Yeah, we would say a significant sign of like, something like that, right?
Yeah, sign of
they don't.
They so, see it as a cause.
No. Well, no, no. They don't see it as a cause.
Uh-huh.
That's the way we translate the word.
Oh, yeah.
I'd say for a cause.
Yeah. Because I don't, it, whenever there's illness, there's fever. We might say that. And if we were to say that, we still wouldn't say that that's the cause in the sense that it's the cause of the illness. It's but, something that always attends illness.
But if you can reduce the fever in any disease.
Reducing the fever.
Does that reduce the illness?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sure it does.
Yeah, fever's not a good thing, right? They don't advocate, go out and get a fever.
No.
It's usually something you want to get rid of, no matter
what.
When doctors go out for a good time, they don't say, hey, let's go out and get a fever.
I think it's something causing the fever.
Beer.
Fire
is not the fever causing the
bugs.
Illness. It's interesting. That what is that relation between fever and illness if it's not cause?
And is it the same thing for the last? Which is whatever it is in the body for it to be alive, that's soul.
And it's yeah.
Like, would you say it's the...
Yeah?
No one I know would say, you know, if you were asking them, what's the cause of the body being alive, it'd say soul. Mm-hmm. Right? You know anyone? I would know. You put that on its test, we'd have to flunk it. Okay, now that we've had some fun, let's go with this one.
We left off with the Atlas? It was saying?
9D.
After this, then,
I'll be glad to give
up investigating realities. Page 323.
Yeah.
Number 48.
We need some readers.
Page 9.
We'll play. 100.
I'll read.
Okay, good. Play sock?
Sure.
Second voice.
We need a CVs. CVs going once.
I'll read both.
Well, can't ask for a better beer than that.
After this then, said he, since I had given up investigating realities, I decided that I must be careful not to suffer the misfortune which happens to people who look at the sun and watch it during an eclipse. That is, after this, then, since I had given up investigating realities,
since I've been in prison now. I decided that I must be careful not to suffer the misfortune that happens to people who look at the sun and watch it during an eclipse. For some of them ruin their eyes unless they look at its image in water or something of the sort. I thought of that danger, and I was afraid my soul would be blinded if I looked at things with my eyes and tried to grasp them with any of my senses. So I thought I must have recourse to conceptions and examine in them the truth of realities. Now, perhaps my metaphor is not quite accurate, for I do not grant in the least that he who studies realities by means of conceptions is looking at them in images any more than he who is studying them in facts of daily life. However, that is the way I begin. I assume in each case some principle which I consider strongly. And whatever seems to me to agree with this, whether relating to cause or to anything else, I regard as true. And whatever disagrees with it is untrue. But I want to tell you more clearly what I mean, for I think you do not understand now. Not very well, certainly. Well, this is what I mean. It is nothing new, but the same thing I have always been saying, both in our previous conversations and elsewhere. I'm going to try to explain to you the nature of that cause which I have been studying, and I will revert to those familiar subjects of ours as my point of departure and assume that there are such things as absolute beauty and good and greatness and the like. If you grant this and agree that these exist, I believe I shall explain cause to you and shall prove that the soul is immortal.
You may assume that I grant it, so go ahead.
Okay. Then, see if you agree with me in the next step. I think that if anything is beautiful besides absolute beauty, it is beautiful for no other reason than because it partakes of absolute beauty. And this applies to everything. You assent to this view of cause.
Is that there in the text? The last line.
Cause?
Bull.
Ponta.
Sarah? What page are we
on? I do. We're on page 345.
100.
Answer.
Of this.
Beauty?
Of cause.
With. Do you have it, Sarah?
Yeah, it's the.
Give wing to your utterance.
Five lines up from D. One, two, three, four. Four lines up from D. The first, last, te, the last.
The next sentence?
What, uh-huh. See where it says sum coro ete?
Yeah.
You're looking for the one right before that. Do you assent to this view?
Yeah.
It's the sum cores. Do you assent? And then there's te. Toyade, I should have before that to this cause
okay,
as follows. And there's a question mark.
So participation is time.
So, would you agree what we have with his idea where I shall explain the cause to him? That's really nice. I shall explain cause to you. And what is he given? Doctrine of participation? That's cause.
Yeah.
I mean, that's cause.
Don't understand cause?
Participation. I do.
Now, I do not yet understand. Nor can I perceive those other ingenious causes. If anyone tells me that what makes a thing beautiful is its lovely color, or its shape, or anything else of the sort, I let all that go, for all those things confuse me. And I hold simply and plainly, and perhaps foolishly, this, that nothing else makes it beautiful but the presence or communion, call it what you please, of absolute beauty, however it may have been gained. About the way in which it happens, I make no positive statement as yet, but
I do insist that beautiful things are made beautiful by beauty. For I think this is the safest answer I can give to myself or to others. And if I cleave fast to this, I think I shall never be overthrown. And I believe it is safe for me or anyone else to give this answer, that beautiful things are beautiful through beauty. Do you agree?
Uh-huh.
Okay. And great things are great, and greater things great.
That's a little more typical, but I guess I do have to agree. Darn it.
And you would not accept the statement if you were told that one man was greater or smaller than another by a head. But you would insist that you say only that every greater thing is greater than another by nothing else than greatness, and that it is greater by reason of greatness, and that which is smaller by nothing else than smallness, and is smaller by reason of smallness. For you would, I think, be afraid of meeting with retort if you said that a man was greater or smaller than another by a head, first that the greater is greater and the smaller is smaller by the same thing. And secondly, that the greater man is greater by a head, which is small. And that is a monstrous thing, that one is great by something that is small. Would you not be afraid of this?
I'd be afraid of dealing with you, and I mean, that's pretty clever, isn't it?
It's great. By greatness.
If you're smaller by a head, of course, the head is small.
Yeah, right.
How can you be great by smallness?
A bit. How can a bit of smallness ever make anything great?
Yeah.
He was a good student.
Yeah, I guess I should.
Then you would be afraid to say that 10 is more than 8 by 2, and that this is the reason it is more. You would say it is more by number than by reason of number. And 2 cubit measure is greater than 1 cubit measure. Not by half, but by magnitude. Would you not? For you would have the same fear.
That's the same thing. Right? That's the same thing.
Uh-huh.
So, what he's doing is, what's the reason it is more?
Yeah. Yeah.
The reason is 8. I mean, the reason 10 is greater than 8 is not by 2. But by reason of the of numbers.
Yeah.
That's why he jumps, right?
Yeah, he jumps kind of like to me. I don't know, how do you view that? In one sense, you could say, well, that's because of the internal integrity of number. Or it's by reason, because it participates in number as some higher thing, right? Or it participates as a member in a whole.
I think that's
he does the same thing in the next example.
A
2-cubit measure is greater than a 1-cubit measure, not by half, but by magnitude.
Uh-huh. These Greeks.
That word reason, though, is the same we've been playing with for cause and condition. It's not
rules
or anything.
Oh, yeah, I did mark that. That's
okay.
Right. Same word. Yeah. Cause. Cause comes out to be reason, condition.
But he's not interested in how it comes about.
No. Yeah. No how.
However it may have been gained. About the way in which it happens, I make no positive statement as yet.
But cause in our culture is how.
It is. It's a how. Huh? Mm-hmm. How did that happen?
Well, be good for me.
He says, I don't care.
That's a how?
That's a how I'm not interested. However it happens, I don't care. I'll tell you the cause of.
How can you do that?
This is where I go for the highest principle. So, oh, why did it do that? Why? I'm going to go for what's safer. I go for the highest principle to explain everything. What's that? Participation.
So the body participates in fever when it's ill.
And
that's right, that's what we had the question the other night.
Mm-hmm. Body participates in well-orderedness.
When it's alive.
When it's alive. Mm-hmm.
It's not cause. It's not what we mean by cause. Okay, let's try some more. How's it coming? Certainly.
then, ha, and well, and then. Well then, if one is added to one, or if one is divided, you would avoid saying that the addition or the division is the cause of two. You would exclaim loudly that you know no other way by which anything can come into existence than by participating in the proper essence of each thing, Lucia, in which it participates. And therefore you accept no other cause of the existence of two than the participation in duality. And things which are to be two must participate in duality. And whatever is to be one must participate in unity. And you would pay no attention to the divisions, additions, and other such subtleties, leaving those for wiser men to explain. You would distrust your inexperience, would be afraid, as the saying goes, of your own shadow. So you would cling to that safe principle of ours, and would reply as I have said. And if anyone attacked the principle, you would pay him no attention, and you would not reply to him until you examined the consequences to see whether they agree with one another or not. And when you had to give an explanation of the principle, you would give it in the same way by assuming some other principle, which seemed to you the best of the higher ones, and so on until you reached one which was adequate. You would not mix things up as disputants do in talking about the beginning and its consequences if you wish to discover any of the realities, for perhaps not one of them thinks or cares in the least about these things. They are so clever that they succeed in being well pleased with themselves even when they mix everything up. But if you are a philosopher, I think you will do as I have said.
That's true. Such thinness and seedies in a chorus. Seldom do they sing so well together as this. The voices harmonizing straight to heaven and hell, permeating the heavens with their harmonies.
By Zeus, Tito, they were right. It seems to me that they made those matters astonishingly clear to anyone with even little sense.
Certainly, Hesperides. And all who were there thought so too.
And so do we, who are not there, and are hearing about it now. But what was said after that?
Well, I remember it. After all this had been admitted, and they had agreed that each of the abstract qualities exists, and that other things which participate in these get their names from them, then Socrates asked, which is an interesting summary of a nice discussion.
Isn't that amazing? Uh-huh. That higher principles, we were musing over that the other night, like if participation is the cause, and if you had to explain that, you have to appeal to something higher than that, right? A higher principle. You know,
which would be
the good, the idea of the good, or something higher. Yeah. Model, call, or what?
Yeah, you have to say, well, the good overflows.
The good overflows. It's necessary for what it is to have an image or something.
Yeah.
Or something. Huh? Or a reflection. Or it has to have reflection. Right?
Now, if you assent to this, do you not? When you say that Simmias is greater than Socrates and smaller than Plato, say that there is in Simmias greatness and smallness. That's yours. Yes.
Now, if you assent to this, do you not, when you say that Simmias is greater than Socrates and smaller than Phaedo, say that there is in Simmias greater and smallness?
Oh, quite true indeed.
But you agree that the statement that Simmias is greater than Socrates is not true as stated in those words. For Simmias is not greater than Socrates by reason of being Simmias, but by reason of the greatness he happens to have. Nor is he greater than Socrates because Socrates is Socrates, but because Socrates has smallness relatively to his greatness. This is the second hypothesis, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yeah.
Right? One in being, not other than being good with one.
True indeed. True.
Then Simmias is called small and great when he is between the two, surpassing the smallness of the one by exceeding him in height, and granting to the other the greatness that exceeds his own smallness. I seem to be speaking like a legal document. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. It really is very much as I say. That's the thing.
It's great.
Right.
I am speaking so because I want you to agree with me. I think it is evident not only that greatness itself will never be great, and also small, but the greatness in us, but that the greatness in us will never admit the small or allow itself to be exceeded. Wait, let me run that by you again, okay?
Good emphasis, too.
And I am speaking so because I want you to agree with me. I think it is evident not only that greatness itself will never be great and also small, but that greatness in us will never admit the small or allow itself to be exceeded. One of the two things must take place. Either it flees or withdraws when its opposite smallness advances towards it, or it has already ceased to exist by the time smallness comes near it. But it will not receive and admit smallness, thereby becoming other than it was. So I have received and admitted smallness, and am still the same person I was. But the greatness in me, being great, has not suffered itself to become small. In the same way, the smallness in us will never become or be great, nor will any other opposite, which is still what it was, ever become or be also its own opposite. It either goes away or loses its existence in the change.
You know, that seems quite evident.
Then one of those present,
I don't remember who it was, said,
"Heaven's name! Is not this present doctrine the exact opposite of what was admitted in an earlier discussion, that the greater is generated from the less and the less from the greater, and that opposites are always generated from their opposites? But now it seems to me we are saying that this can never happen."
Right. Remember that way back in 7 AD. Mm-hmm. Socrates cocked his head on one side and listened.
"You have spoken up like a man, but you do not observe the difference between the present doctrine and that which was said before. We said before, in the case of concrete things, opposites are generated from opposites. Whereas now we say that the abstract concept of an opposite can never become its own opposite, either in us or in the world about us. Then we were talking about things which possess opposite qualities and are called after them. But now, about those very opposites, the immanence of which gives the things their names. We say that these latter can never be generated from each other."
At the same time, he looked at Ceres and said,
"And you? Are you troubled by any of our friends' objections?"
"No, not this time, though I confess that objections often do trouble."
"Well, we are quite agreed upon this, that an opposite can never be its own opposite."
"That's clear, and I entirely agree with you."
"Now see if you agree with me in what follows. Is there something that you call heat, something you call cold?"
"That's something I can answer with a great deal of confidence, Socrates, yes."
"If you've ever taken a bath. Are they the same as snow and fire?"
"Not at all."
"But heat is a different thing from fire and cold different from snow."
"Oh, quite true."
"Yes, yet I fancy you believe that snow, if to employ the form of phrase we used before, admits heat."
"If it admits it."
"Yeah, thanks. I couldn't do any further. I was dumb. to be another word. Yet I fancy you believe that snow, if, to employ the form of our phrase we used before, it admits heat, will no longer be what it was, namely snow, and also warm, but will either withdraw when heat approaches, or it will cease to exist.
Quite true.
And similarly, fire, when cold approaches it, will either withdraw or perish. It will never succeed in admitting cold and being still fire, as it was before, and also cold.
This is not as clear as it should be, Socrates.
Well, the fact is, it's not in some of your such cases. Well, the fact is it not, that in some such cases, that not only the abstract idea itself has a right to the same name through all time, but also something else, which is not the idea, but which always, whenever it exists, has the form of the idea.
Yeah, let's go back to that.
Sure. What, the principle and opposite can never be a turn opposite?
That's well,
pretty sound.
Yeah, the one on the bottom, the example uses a fire.
Uh-huh.
And similarly, fire, when cold approaches it, will either withdraw or perish.
Does that make sense?
Well, if you reduce the cold, now it's wind.
Okay. We're just dropping temperature.
Yeah, just dropping temperature.
That's a fire triangle, man. I learned that from Boy Scouts.
What's that?
Heat, mm-hmm. fuel, and oxygen. Mm-hmm. Take away any of those, you take away the fire.
But does that mean then on the coldest conceivable condition you can't light a match?
That's right.
Absolute zero?
That's right.
Sure. No.
Exactly what that means.
No way.
No, you can't meet the kindling temperature, therefore it won't light.
Won't light. Hmm. Heat, right? Fire has a certain form, right? Has to have a certain...
But it has to have a certain degree of heat present
before
it can ignite.
Before it can ignite.
And if it gets too cold, you can't light a fire.
Can't light it.
Can't light a fire.
Well, I'm very glad to hear that. Right? Because that saves me an exploration. Okay, great.
Isn't that true?
I'm sorry.
Isn't that true?
What's the trend?
Well, fuel, heat, and oxygen.
But you couldn't light a match in really cold weather, even if you had... matches and wood and
yes, given all the conditions.
Well, like in the Antarctic, could you light a match?
Wouldn't be cold enough. If you could light the match, is that's the theory?
So it's cold enough, you just can't light the match.
You couldn't light the match. There'd be some.
It's not that you couldn't strike it. Wouldn't ignite.
Well, when you strike it, doesn't that create friction, which causes?
Well,
but it would be absorbed so quickly that
cold would have to damp out any friction.
So fast.
The cold would have to damp out.
Damp out. As you slid along,
there's not much oxygen in cold. There's no heat.
Yeah, right.
He says it would disperse in the
cold. What about that freeze drying stuff?
Heat from friction.
You
know, pull into the cold.
I'll learn something new today.
Maybe that's true. I don't know. This is a belief at this point. Let's test it. Let's get a lab.
Yeah, that's really interesting.
No, it's molecular action. If it's cold enough, if you're down at -7274, which is where no molecules move, there can't be any fire. Absolute zero. You know, it's some point where you can't get enough heat to cause enough molecular action to bring about fire.
Well, it's not even that, Bill. The problem is more basic, isn't it? You don't have to worry about generating fire. It's just when fire can exist.
Yeah, well, I'm saying, for it to combine with oxygen, there has to be a certain amount of molecular action.
Like if we had a fire here in the room, and it had abundant fuel, was being fed, right?
Yeah.
And we just started dropping the temperature. Right? We had the capability to drop the temperature, you know, infinitely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Would that still be able to burn?
No.
You know, have to go out.
It would just whether or not the heat transfer would where you
even
could
though it give it gas, propane, whatever. Couldn't give it enough to overcome the cold, then that would just be changing the equation.
Mm-hmm. Because the propane would become a liquid.
The fuel. That's right, the basic fuel would turn to ice, isn't it?
Yeah.
It was carbon or something.
Well, how would they know this? How would Socrates know this?
If we have to go to 274, -274 to talk about molecular rigidity,
Yeah, I know.
Well, yeah.
Okay, good, good, good.
Is that it? Will you understand that?
No, it means that, what that means is that we can appeal to something in our contemporary science that agrees with it, whether that's understanding or not.
Yeah, right.
Probably a different other thing.
What was his argument, right? Why was he convinced? That was the question.
Well,
fire is...
Yes, see, that's true.
He seems to be, what he's saying seems to be fundamental somehow to fire.
He had the basic pre-Socratic physics course.
Elements only fit together in certain ways. So.
Yeah, I wonder if it was all grammatical. You could deduce it that way.
Rod, did you ever have yellow phosphorus in the chem lab? Well, they kept it underwater. Kindling temperature is 72 degrees.
No, I never did.
Instantaneous combustion at 72 degrees. You don't have to light a match, you don't have to do anything, you just expose it to 72 degrees in oxygen and boom, you got a fire. So they cover it with water to keep it cool and to keep the oxygen away. So using Rod's rule, you're trying to do two things there, keep the temperature down and the second, remove the oxygen.
That was the basic you said on the fire department, the human in the school, and the Boy Scouts. The fire, your basic fire triangle. You have a fire in your kitchen, move one of the three elements and you'll stop the fire.
Bring in coal.
Turn on the refrigerator.
Take away the oxygen, take away the fuel.
And
take
get in the refrigerator.
Good. All right, then it's easy to do the paragraph where I just read.
The fact is, in some such cases, that not only the abstract idea itself has a right to the same name through all time, but also something else, which is not the idea, but which always, whenever it exists, has the form of the idea. The more...
That's the next part that you need to read.
But perhaps I can make my meaning clearer by some examples.
Glad to hear it, Socrates.
In numbers. Now there's an area you ponder. The odd must always have the name of odd, must it not?
I would be willing to say that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That, even though that seems odd.
You'll come off unscathed. But is this the only thing, so-called? For this is what I mean to ask. This is what I mean to ask. Or is there something else which is not identical with the odd, but nevertheless has a right to the name of odd in addition to its own name? Because it is of such a nature that it is never separated from the odd. I mean, for instance, the number three. And there are many other examples. Take the case of three. Do you think it may always be called by its own name? And also be called odd, which is not the same as three. Yet the number three and the number five and half of the numbers in general are so constituted that each of them is odd, though not identified with the idea of odd. But in the same way, two, four, and all the other series of numbers are even, each of them which is not identical with evenness. Do you agree or not?
No, I go along with that.
Okay.
I've known some numbers in my day.
Now see what I want to make plain.
That's not easy.
Okay, well, I'll try. This is my point, that not only abstract opposites exclude each other, but all things which, although not opposite one to another, always contain opposites. These also, we find, exclude the idea, which is opposed to the idea contained in them. And when it approaches, they either perish or withdraw. We must certainly agree that the number three will endure destruction or anything else rather than submit to becoming even, while still remaining three, must be not.
Yeah.
Okay. But the number two is not the opposite of the number three.
No.
then not only opposite ideas refuse to admit each other when they come near, but certain other things refuse to admit the approach of opposites.
That's true.
Shall we then determine, if we can, what these are?
Certain.
Then seems, will they be those which always compel anything of which they take possession, not only to take their form, but also that the opposite?
What do you mean?
Glad you asked. Let me see what I mean myself. Then will they be those which always compel anything of which they take possession, not only to take their form, but also that of the opposite?
Some.
Oh, that of some opposite, right. But also that of some opposite. What do you mean? Such things as we were speaking of just now. You know, of course, that those things in which the number three is an essential element must be not only three, but also odd.
Oh, yeah, sure.
Now, such a thing can never admit the idea which is the opposite of the concept which produces this result.
No. Can't that be?
But the result was produced by the concept of the odd.
Mm-hmm.
And the opposite of this is the idea of even.
Oh, yeah.
Then the idea of even will never be admitted by the number three.
No, it had to go on strike first.
Then three is no part in even.
No.
Then the number three is uneven.
Quite true.
Now I propose, since we've agreed here, now I propose to determine what things, without being the opposite of something, nevertheless refused to admit as the number three, though it was not the opposite of the idea of even, nevertheless refuses to admit it, but always brings forward its opposite against it. And as the number two brings forward the opposite of the odd, and fire that of cold, and so forth, for there are plenty of examples. Now see if you accept this statement. Not only will opposites not admit their opposite, but nothing which brings an opposite to that which it approaches will ever admit in itself the oppositeness of that which is brought. Now let me refresh your memory. For there's no harm in repetition. The number five will not admit the idea of the even, nor will ten, the double of five, admit the idea of the odd. Now, 10 is not itself an opposite, and yet it will not admit the idea of the odd. And so, 1.5, and other mixed fractions, 1/3, and other simple fractions, reject the idea of the whole. Do you go with me in agreeing to this?
Yeah, I'm entirely agreeing. No, I'm with you.
Okay. And please begin again at the beginning. And do not answer my questions in their own words, but do as I do. I give an answer beyond the safe answer, which I spoke of at first. Now that I see another safe way, a safe reply deduced from what has just been said. If you ask me what causes anything in which it is to be hot, I will not give you the safe but stupid answer and say that it is heat. But I can now give a more refined answer, that it is fire. And if you ask, what causes the body in which it is to be ill, I shall not say illness but fever. And if you ask, what causes a number in which it is to be odd, I shall not say oddness but the number one, and so forth. Do you understand sufficiently what I mean?
Quite sufficiently.
Now answer. What causes the body in which it is to be alive?
Oh, the soul, as everybody knows.
Is this always the case?
Oh, obviously.
Then if the soul takes possession of anything, it always brings life to it.
Quite true.
Is there anything that is the opposite of life?
Sure.
What?
Yeah.
Now the soul, as we have agreed before, will never admit the opposite of that which it brings with it.
Precisely.
Then, what do we now call that which does not admit the idea of the even?
Uneven.
And those which do not admit justice and music?
Unjust and unmusical.
Well then, what do we call that which does not admit death?
Deathless or the immortal.
And the soul does not admit death?
No.
Then the soul is immortal.
Mm-hmm.
There's your proof, Paul.
And
very well. Shall we say then that this is proof?
Yes.
Very satisfactorily, Socrates.
What do you think of that?
Somebody called it an end run over here.
It's a trick.
Of course, it's a trick.
See that?
It must be simple.
Yeah, see board? That's it.
TV at home.
What's interesting about this whole argument, so interesting in respect to it being typical of a lot of other arguments, he doesn't go to what he's really interested in until he has all the principles down. He has all the examples.
Yeah.
He has the whole structure developed. Then he turns and he says, by the way, let's take our particular issue and put it right into the structure. It goes four steps and it's all over. All the work is on the structure and the principles that produce it.
Yeah. Snow. That fire.
You'll agree there's such a thing as fire?
Yeah.
That's where it starts.
Yeah. 1 and 2.
Yeah, odd even. All of that stuff. Just to come down to this. 1, 2, 3, then he applies.
I like that. One is uneven.
What's the cause of odd? One.
It's always odd.
Right? That's the cause of odd. One.
It's also the cause of even.
That's true.
Now, classically, most definitions consider one to be the intervening unit, which always produces odd.
Yeah, 2 plus 1.
I mean, it does fit that.
2 n + 1?
Yeah. It's always the intervening unit. One. It's always cause evenness, too.
Let's say 2 causes evenness.
No, not necessarily. If you have 3, or if you have 5, it won't cause
evenness. That's what you start.
Yeah.
But if you have an odd number, that's always one left over.
That's right. Intervening unit. Yeah, they base it on that division process. Right? Yeah. Can't divide it equally.
Was she too odd?
Well, the definition of odd is of its nature that it can't be divided equally. That's a fundamental. When it shows up, I've seen in a lot of Greek, most Greek mathematics, that something is uneven if it can't be divided equally. There's always some intervening unit.
Well, what do you think we should do with this? Now that we've gone through it. Shall we make a vote? I have a suggestion that Kang asks.
Ask Kang.
What is it?
Why don't we get Paul to do it next week?
Yeah, now that he's seen it.
He'd be happy to do it as soon as he sees it.
God, I should have brought a book tonight. I apologize.
Okay.
I found this book in the library. It has Chuang Tzu. Mm. And it's got his comments at Lao Tzu's death. Mm-hmm. And it's comments at the death of his wife. And it's a great little dialogue, you know.
Could you
call it?
No, I don't know if one of the parts I can't recall. It was some nice reflection. One fellow who's a student of Lao Tzu's went to see Lao Tzu. And, was it Lao Tzu?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it would be.
Yeah, it was on the death of Lao Tzu, but it was... Oh, yeah, he sat down in front of Lao Tzu, and what the heck was it? No, it was Chuang... No, I can't recall it. I got it mixed up. Chuang Tzu at the death of his wife. I forget the story about Lao Tzu, but fellow his came to see him. He was sitting there on the ground with his legs spread at a right angle, it said. And he was beating on a bowl. And fellow said something called, no, I can't recall the principle, sorry. Fellow said something to the effect of, is this the proper behavior? And the way he answered was such that it was like that if the people around him mourning, if when somebody died, the people surrounding the person were mourning, and the person had really not a very good effect on the people in their life that weren't able to communicate something about the reality of, it was kind of a nice deathlessness.
So he was beating her.
Yeah, it was, his wife would be ashamed of him, right? And the one thing, actually, I should have brought it. I didn't have a library. Didn't have the magazine on. Oh.
Gina, what should we do with this argument? Since Barbara sneaked out.
We had a chorus in the background saying it was a trick.
Pardon?
We had a chorus that was saying it was a trick. We could vote on whether it's a convincing argument, a trick.
Well, would you agree at least that he's using the word cause in a way that's totally different than anything?
It's not dealing with hells.
Yeah, it's dumped right in the middle of the discussion, too, right? This whole thing comes up in the CB's riff. Right?
Mm-hmm. That's what I remember.
That's strange view of cause.
Strange view of cause.
Soul.
The cause of the body of the world.
Soul.
Participation.
No, not just participation. Participation in concrete would make a lot.
Well, I can't. What do you think? What do you think we ought to do?
Well, we should go back and re-examine the premises, just like he says. He told us in the text.
That's right.
If we have any question about
the... any questions on what you have to do,
challenge
you got to go back.
Yeah. Question. Very rich passage.
How many answers, Mark?
For me, I'll take it in the living
room. Oh, you got some friends that will answer for it. But since the thing is, I don't see how I can doubt the argument as the result of the discussion, but the subject is so great and have such a poor opinion of human weakness, I can't help having some doubt in my own mind about what has been said. Not only that, Cynics, it's obvious, but our first assumptions ought to be more carefully examined, even though they seem here to be certain. And if you're analyzing completely, well, I think following the degree of the argument, so far as it is possible in them to do so, that is made clear. No need to seek any further.
Yeah.
Right.
That's nice.
What were you reading, Pierre? I was looking.
It's the next page. I just jumped in.
Yeah, the next page is great. The all and the God and the principle of life. Those are immortal and perishables. Whereabouts? Right on the.
369.
Yeah. 369. Yeah. Not only now that seems. Mm-hmm. But our first assumptions have to be more carefully examined.
So why don't we go back to the next week?
Okay.
We all know what to do.
Time to mull on it.
Time to mull on it. Kick it around.
More carefully examine the first assumption.
Yeah.
Right.
Because from this point then it's perfectly certain that the soul is immortal and imperishable, and our souls will exist somewhere in another world. Yeah.
So,
here it goes.
You have to be able to accept the metaphysics of participation.
Yes, that's essential.
To get this, if you can't, you can't get this argument. Mm-hmm. That's right.
And so if we want to demonstrate that, or we got to look for higher principles in order to see that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if, but like the whole, the Stoics and Aristotle won't be able to get this, because they won't be able to accept the metaphysics of participation.
What are the Stoics? They got the wax tablet?
Mm-hmm.
That apprehensive representation, what do you call it? Or the Hume.
That's right, David Hume.
That's right. 100%. I got that from you. Yeah, that's right. That's the wax tablet?
Is that what they call it?
No, they don't. Do they call it that? I don't.
He doesn't have the wax tablet, he has the wax. Descartes has the wax.
Yeah.
David Hume has the impression.
Freshly culled from the hive.
Yeah, as I know, it's freshly
culled. What the hell is culled? I always liked it.
still retains the odor.
Uh-huh. He waxed poetically.
It was his finest line.
That was great. That's what I remember. That's good.
Well, then we will start at the second voyage in quest of the cause.
Okay.
The second voyage.
Now,
maybe we should take a boat trip to go along with it.
Barbara, by the way, had some very interesting references to the Greek. And she promised to give us a quick talk about it.
Yes.
Over a cup of coffee.
All right. Okay, my cup is ready.
So all you have to do is ask her, and she'll be very pleased to tell you.
What? What are you pleased to tell
you? Before about...
Before?
Yeah.
All right. Over a cup of coffee? Who needs to refill their cup? Or right now? All right.
I'll slide it in here.
Zero is not a number.
No Greek. No Greek never said that. Great.
What do you got here?
Afterthought, it says.
Oh, Freud and the psychoanalytic movement. Good luck.
Book.
Oh, that's the Seven Psychologists?
Yeah.
Oh, that's great. It's on paperback.
I guess so.
Oh, this was out of print for years.
Oh, what's that?
Did you get it at Irvine?
Oh, yeah. This is a very famous edition. Yeah. This is a very famous edition.
I think there's some at Irvine. I ordered a bunch before I left.
Oh, this is really fun.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was looking for it in the library.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have
it. Bookstore.
Oh,
they have the Shockian, too.
Yeah. Oh, shoot, there's some things around data. There's a brilliant introduction.
Seven Psychologies, 1933.
Oh, that's really a fine piece of work. Clear writer. Edna.
Heidegger.
That I discovered, I was looking for something else in the Republic, and I was reading through, and so I went into the Phaedo because I got a question about what was being used for ship there, and so this is like just a glimpse of this. I haven't researched it completely, okay, but I think it's something that you might enjoy playing with. These are the references in the first introduction to the Phaedo where they're talking about the voyage. And the first one that I've given here, for those of you who don't have the text, is the one it's where it says, why was it Phaedo? And the Phaedo answers, it was a matter of chance, Echecrates. It happened that the stern of the ship, which the Athenians send to Delos, was crowned on the day before the trial. So that's where I picked up the first. So that's where these passages begin. Before we look at these, though, let me just show you a little bit what's happening with the Greek and give you one strategic thing that I always do, which is to see what isn't being used. This word is naus. Like, we get nautilus from
this.
So
where we get the word
nautical. Huh? That's where you get the word naus. Yeah. Nautical. Having to do with, in the Greek, it means a ship. Okay, it means the actual boat. Okay, but what you see being used when they're talking about the ship sent to Delos is not that term. Mm-hmm. Most specifically, the most interesting one is this one. And to understand what's going on here, take a look here. Thereo, which we've looked at in the Republic, means to look at, to view or behold. It's the verb. To contemplate, they give on the level of the mind. It's the word used when you're talking about viewing the public games. In an absolute sense, to do this kind of looking is to be a person, a theoros, who is a state ambassador either to the oracle at Delphi or Delos. They gave these specifically, or to be a spectator at the four most important games for the Athenian state. They give a list of names, but I didn't put them here. And then, further, the name of, as you can see here.
No.
Go ahead.
What would you call someone who went to the Olympics?
That's it.
You would only use it for that.
Yeah. The Olympics are one of the four great games. The Olympics, the Nemean, the Isthmian.
Here's the end.
Okay. If you want that list, I could. Would you like to hear that list? It's four of them. If you want to, I'll get it for you. Okay, but the Olympics is definitely one of them. So it's like, this is a pretty.
It would really have to be a very significant game.
Yes.
Right?
It's not any game.
And not any priest.
Right.
But the oracle at Delphi.
A stained ambassador to the oracle only at those two places, the most significant, Delphi or...
Not Delphi.
Or Delos.
Apollo or Zeus, huh? No way. Delos, that was Artemis.
Asha,
Apollo?
Come on.
No, we're talking
now.
Oh, yeah, we're talking now.
Go see. Go see.
Olympics, that's Zeus.
Go ahead.
That's what it's called. Delphi, Apollo. Delphi, Artemis.
So, and what's interesting is that the same ship that we're talking about in Phaedo that is delaying the trial of Socrates goes by a special name. It's called Theoris, which comes from the same root for the same sacred kind of being a spectator or ambassador, from the same kind of state of mind, this contemplation, that boat, and all the people who go on it. It's called a Theoris, they're called Theoroi.
God, there's not interesting.
What do you see something?
Well, just the because it raises that sacred ship to the level of those other activities.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it would have to be, because in Greece, what was the most significant event? No one was allowed to be put to death during that time.
Purification
of the whole city. A long ancient history. It must have gone back as we know it. That event must have been a 1,000-year-old ritual. Because the Cretan Empire was over at 1400 BC through the destruction by the fire and earthquake. So we're talking about like a 1,000-year-old legend that's still cooking at that time. Now, what's the eidos at the end of that?
That's the
is that a contraction
genitive.
From
no, that's just the genitive from which, that's just a genitive form. I put that on inconsistently. I forgot. I didn't list it there.
I have to do it.
From eidos or something?
No, I was going for autos.
Yeah. Okay, so...
That's very interesting. Yeah, okay, go
ahead. I was just thinking that what fascinates me is, like, he could have referred to it, you could say to yourself, you could argue, well, that's just the name of it. It doesn't have a real significance. I mean, that's the name of the boat. They give it that name. I mean, it, in the text. What I find significant is he doesn't at any point refer to it in this section as ship, you know? He calls it either this word, which means a sailing or a voyage, and therefore refers to that journey, or he calls it this term.
What's the word he uses in the second voyage that we were just into?
Ooh, I don't know.
Same plume.
Plume? Would be a form of that. So to my mind, it always makes it stronger when there's an option close at hand, simple.
Sure.
And he doesn't go for it. So the fact that he doesn't use this conscious emphasis on this idea. But he just called it mission is the way that this I don't know what the Rouse does with it, but in this he calls it the mission to Delos. And,
that's right.
So.
The whole rich structure you're saying, he doesn't bring the life.
Right. He doesn't bring it. He gets the sacredness idea in the sense of mission, I guess. So that's pretty
simple. Not have any sense of the sacred. Doesn't play any role in it, I think. Ken, when you looked up the second voyage,
mm-hmm.
You're saying that's Boileau?
Yeah, it's related to it.
It's the accusative or something?
Well, yeah, I think so. P-L-O-U-N, plume. And there's a...
Like that?
Yeah, and there's a thing over the U.
Circumflex?
Yeah, or? Circumflex over the gear, which means the main part of the case.
I think that's the accusative form.
Do you know, sir? I don't know.
It's just a straight masculine noun.
That doesn't have an I in it, that form.
That's right, that one does. That one does.
That would be different. I have my handy dandy.
No, there's no iota.
You're going to make me work. I'm going to have to open my book.
Oh, to look at that thing?
It's normal sticker.
The plume says it's an Attic contraction for plus, which is a sailing voyage. It's different from ployon, which is a floating vessel, ship, craft.
Oh, did that really screw that up? Is the noun?
No, there's two different nouns. There's two nouns. There's ployon, that's you've got, and he's referring to whole plus, it looks like. I haven't looked at the word, but there are two words in the lexicon.
Interesting. So there is a noun, a sailing vessel, but it's still not the noun, it's still not nous, which it could be.
Yeah, well, it looks like it's probably related to plus, pleo as a related verb. And so ployon also lists pleo as its related verb, so they both have pleo, which is to sail, go by sea.
That's the actual verb for the second trip.
That's what
the
said,
other one
that
I'm screwing.
Well, you could have plural too.
Floating vessel.
Where's the second word?
343, top of the page, second line down, second word in.
Thanks. 343, second line down, second word in, or?
No, on the Greek side, sorry.
Deuteron and plume.
So where'd you come up with them?
Well, there, I was looking at plus, which is in fact the voyage. And there's another term, which is ployon, and that is the sailing vessel, derived from the verb. In the same way.
Oh, okay.
But it looks to me like they want to say it comes from the verb this way. So it is a ship term then, which they're using, but it's still not the simplest and most direct physical reference that they could use, and that's common. This one.
Oh, we got the sacredness out of this here. It's no light thing to.
And this is the term. Sorry, this is the term he's using in the second voyage. It's this one. Second sailing. But before, where he's talking about the vessel, he's talking about a sailing vessel. Mm-hmm. And they say this is opposed to this word, which is a merchant ship. I think the lexicon said.
A wine ship?
A jugboat.
Jugboats are coming. Sales are inside.
Is there a Buddhist concept of going between two shores?
I don't know.
Wasn't there a seminar that was once done on that?
I don't know. I may have
Barbara,
been there.
I think you had another point, or maybe it's just another.
What is it?
Using the word contemplation.
That was the whale watchers.
Yeah, that was. When I was talking to Gina, I was making it more specific that it was a voyage of contemplation that Sock was taking these 14 guys on. Right? They become the Theoroi.
That's when you said that, Barbara, I put it in the term of you go on a whale watching boat and you're a whale watcher, right?
Right.
So the grammar fits.
Sacred fish.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's the same old thing next week. Right? Same old thing next week.
Oh, yeah, the lights
are all old.
Right. But not as long as we did the third hypothesis.
Once more.
Let us discuss the matter once more for the third time.
We're doing this.
Yes, I will never
forget that.
Third hypothesis.
Yeah.
Come back
over.
How many times
did
we go?
No, no.
10?
Oh, yeah. Okay.
No, we have
5.
Well, I was here. I don't know how far you guys have gone into it before.
Yeah.
But I think we did about 5 times. Voyage in the first half
of tomorrow. All right. God, that must be fun.
Well, I still don't
like to see
but that.
That
color's pretty nice, isn't it?
Yeah. And it's so crystal.
Isn't it so clear? Look at that.
Oh, wow.
Oh, look at Ken.
Look at Ken, you look great.
Oh, smile
a little bit.
Your fame.
Look directly.
Yeah, look directly.
Look at that. That looks good.
That's great.
Does Angel Wine sees it. She's going to say, how much did he get paid?
Are you actually filming now, or is it just going through the monitor while all the red lights on?
How much is a roll of film?
$5.88.
God, that's chicken.
How much? How long?
6 hours.
6 hours.
Six hours.
That's cheaper than Kodak and
Chicago. We won't wait to come down and watch all the latest movies.
And you can get it cheaper than that, though.
The film?
Yeah, the video. They run cheaper now.
Yeah. I just want it to last for 20 years.
Well, I can see
what?
I want it to last for 20 years. I figure I ought to last 20 more years.
What?
The film? The
camera?
Hey.
Film. Good night.
Good night.
Thanks.
I have to train some animals.
Don't forget Paddington.
Marsupial.
Oh, yes, Paddington. You got Paddington in your pocket?
No.
The bear?
She's there?
I put him in there. In your pocket.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Fine.
Would you like? Yeah,
no. My left? Okay. Do you have a license?
Yeah.
All right.
I'm sure it's close to
all right.